Hi, I'm John Doyle, and I'm the Artistic Director of Classic Stage Company. Welcome to Classic Conversations. And if you're new to us, you know, I'd like to give you just a little background as to how this works. For some time now at the theatre, we have been doing this series of conversations between myself and an artist who is either in our work at the time or is associated with the company in some way. We had to pause in rehearsal, of course, for our upcoming production of Assassins. And so the idea that we decided to develop was to do these conversations online with members of that company. The conversations follow very loosely a much loved radio show in the United Kingdom called Desert Island Discs. The format of Desert Island Discs is that the castaway talks to the host of the event about the pieces of music that they would take with them to their desert island. In our normal live version, the castaway will sing a series of songs. For this 30-minute online version, the castaway can choose something that they'd like to share with you. It can be a song, it can be a poem, it can be a favorite piece of writing, a quote, anything they'd like to share, which can become part of our conversation. So, please join me in welcoming this week's castaway, Steven Pasquale. Steven, how are you?
I'm great, John. It's great to talk to you.
Oh, it's lovely to see you. How are you coping with all this?
You know, as well as to be expected, I think. It's I'm a pretty fast-paced person, so having to go this slow is a real challenge. But it's ultimately maybe good for us.
How is it as well? Like, and please take this the best way possible because you're married to the most lovely woman. But how is it two actors living in a home under these circumstances?
I would imagine in most cases it's like murderous.
Must be
terrible. But I just happen to be married to Pippa, who's the easiest human being I've ever met in my life.
Right.
And it's impossible to not just swimmingly get along with her for anyone who knows her. But I do know a lot of actors who are quarantined together who may not make it through.
I know. I mean, if nothing else, the sense of, I mean, like, it's normally must be bad enough. Like, oh, you got a job, I didn't. You know, all that.
Right. That's right.
In the nervousness of this situation, and also the sense of, somebody was visiting with us yesterday, a very dear friend who's a costume designer, but highly experienced costume designer. And she was saying, you know, like it's going to take for her, could take more than a year for her career to get going again. Because as we all know, you've got it, while you're doing one job, you're trying to get the next one planned or the one after that planned, and nobody can make that shape anymore.
It's so strange. And, you know, even with our beautiful production of Assassins that was halted, you know, that was very sort of, for a lot of us, carefully like built into a perfect window, you know?
I know.
And so it's the idea of like just everyone pushing unpause and then trying to get everything back in order is it's challenging to think about.
It is challenging. And yet somehow you can't think ahead either. Like, it's just a void if you're not careful. So you can't go to that place in your head, you know?
We're forced to be totally present, which is not something we're forced to do very often, but.
No, and maybe good. I don't know. I mean, maybe that's good. I feel for all the people all the young actors who have come into New York are just about to start and then nothing happens. I mean,
I teach a class every spring at the NYU grad program.
Do you?
And my students this year were like, they're warriors and they want so badly to get on the treadmill of making a life as an actor. And the fact that they just can't start yet.
Yeah.
And then right as they're graduating from conservatory.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like that. I said to them that this mental challenge may never happen again. So if you can get through this,
that's right.
Your head on straight, you're going to be fine. You know,
that's right. I've been meaning to, I didn't know you taught, but I was going to ask you, and I don't know what I'm basing this on really, other than a feeling of you in a rehearsal room. Mm-hmm. Are you an actor who's interested in directing? Cause it strikes me that you could be.
Very much so, yeah. I've actually begun that process a little bit. I'm getting my feet wet. I've got a couple of ideas that I've been kicking around. I'm enormously intimidated by it. But I feel like something that I really understand is sculpting a performance.
Yeah.
And helping to sculpt a performance in terms of the meaning. But the other stuff, I'm very nervous about. The design elements and the...
Well, me too.
...need to happen. And, you know, so it's new to me, but it's interesting that you sort of intuited that.
It's interesting too, though. I mean, I think when we come out the other end of this, all the things that you're talking about that may be scary, but one of the things that scares me about the theatre is technology. You know, like you walk into one of those big technical rehearsals on Broadway and you think, oh God, I mean, everybody's speaking a language that I just don't understand. But actually, I think after this terrible time that we're in, there's not going to be the money to spend in theatre anymore in the way there was. And I think actually theatre is going to be made in a simpler, actor-based way.
It's so interesting that you said that, because we had a couple of friends over the other night, Adam Chandler Barat being one of them.
Yeah.
They're our quarantine neighbors.
Yeah.
And we were saying, like, what is it going to look like at the end of this? Mm-hmm. And I thought, you know what? There's a possibility that it will be very traumatic, obviously, and sad, because we're going to lose a lot of shows. We're going to lose a lot of long-run shows. Tourists are not going to come for a while.
No.
But there is a chance that it could be an explosion of a different kind of theater for the 9.5 million people that live in this place.
I do believe it will be. You know? I really do believe it will be. And I think people are going to have to make theater in a different way. The expectation is going to be different. For quite a long time, people are even going to look at how much they charge people to go to the theater, because people aren't going to have that money. Investors aren't going to be around. You know, people's portfolios have gone south. I mean, this is not to say that this needed to happen. I don't mean that for a moment. But if there's anything positive in it, that will be the case.
You know, I'm one of those actors who's been for years has been saying we have to be so careful with our beloved Broadway community, because we're one inch from becoming Las Vegas.
Correct.
And this may be our opportunity to remind ourselves why the greatest theater in the world happens in New York, you know what I mean? As opposed to something that's solely made for tourists, because that's where the profitable dollars are. If profit is the only thing we care about, we should have all been bankers.
Correct, correct. And maybe there will have to be, please God, there may be more plays than musicals, because they are not so expensive to stage. So that might change.
Imagine that, John.
Wouldn't that be good? Don't you think?
I mean, somebody said the other day, in the 40s and the 50s and the 60s, there would be like, I'm going to misremember it, 80 or 90 openings on Broadway in a season. Now we've got, you know, a quarter of that many. Oh, yeah. We get back to a real like turntable of like shows coming and going and succeeding and failing. And then like get that treadmill sounds really like sexy from an acting standpoint.
I think so. And I also think that will then create a different yardstick for the word succeeding. You know, it always has saddened me that it's deemed a success or a hit if it recoups and makes money, right? It's not, whereas, of course, nobody wants to be throwing money at the wall. I'm not saying that, but everybody, like, rethink what success means.
Yeah, we must rethink it, right? I mean, look at Steve Sondheim, right? Can we go back in the history of Sondheim and think about things that were really profitable? Probably not that many, right?
And the
profit?
Absolutely not.
Yeah, I mean, that's...
I remember
we all want to work on that stuff, you know.
Yeah, I remember when I did that revival of Sweeney Todd on Broadway, and I don't know, you never quite know what's true when people use these, you know, generalized quotes. Right. But you know, a lot of people were saying, "Oh, this is one of the first Sondheim musicals to recoup," and I thought, "Is that true?" And I thought, "Well, maybe." I mean, you know, we know that Pacific Overtures didn't. You know, we know that there's some that just didn't. Couldn't make it in that way, whereas a little version of something, a big show done by a smaller company in a specific way, could do that. Very, very interesting. But you know what's, well, the minute we talk about Sondheim, I picture you and I, the first time we sat down and talked at Amy's Bread on 9th
Avenue. That's right, good memory, John.
Yeah, and you know, I mean, what's so glorious there is that kind of success with him has never seemed to be the priority, either with him or John Wideman. Yeah. Do you know? The work is the priority, and that's what's so wonderful. Yeah.
I mean, and if you think, we as artists think, is it really conceivable that Sweeney Todd and Sonny and the Park with George weren't huge profitable hits? Like, is that even conceivable to me, because it's so clearly work that is the greatest work that has been, you know. And I'd put Assassins in that category too, as you know.
Absolutely. And I mean, you know, the great turning points of the American musical theater. But I don't think they were. And, you know, when you think that, and again, I don't want to generalize because it's not fair, but when you think that shows like Sunday or I think Into the Woods as well, you know, they had to go to Playwrights Horizons to be put on in the first place. They weren't being put on Broadway.
Right.
I mean, they went to Broadway.
Yeah, even then.
You'd have thought that by then they'd earned their place, you know, and that Assassins didn't go to Broadway the first time around. And there's a perfect example of a piece that has grown into becoming a masterpiece, but it's the same piece, you know?
Right. Yeah. I wonder if it was sort of was it received as well?
No.
At first?
No.
Complicated at first?
No. The reviewers, as far as I know, and I suppose when people talk about the reviewers, they really mean the New York Times, don't they? The New
York Unfortunately, Times, they do. You know,
the New York Times, as far as I know, didn't like it, really. But listen, I wanted to talk to you about your Broadway work, because you've done some really classy shows on Broadway, haven't you? I mean, like, not the big commercial pieces so much, but some really classy work. Was that by choice?
Yes. When I was a young actor, I thought I was being what you were supposed, being and pursuing and doing what you were supposed to be doing as a young, what I thought young, a young up and coming actor should do. And that was like pursuing as much as possible, you know, doing as theater as often as possible, but making sure I was making my headway in my TV film life and blah, blah, blah. And I learned very early on that I don't necessarily want that. Yeah. So in my like late 20s, early 30s, I made a real effort to just spend as much of my time making theater as possible and treat all the other stuff as a way to fund my theater habit.
Yeah. Yeah.
And ironically, right when that decision sort of was made in my soul, a lot of really interesting, great, classy, smart theater came out of the woodwork, Junk and American Sun and Reasons to Be Pretty and even Bridges, which is a commercial idea but written by such smart people.
Absolutely.
It was a real like intentional thing. I'm slightly allergic to the jukebox musicals, as much as I love seeing them and my friends in them. I'm slightly allergic to that sort of model.
Yeah, me too.
So I'm like, I feel like a dinosaur. I'm like, give me a score.
Yeah, me too.
You know?
And don't just give me a score that's generically like everything else. I mean, like, you know, that's when you say about Bridges, you know, there's a unique piece of theater.
Yeah.
And that beautiful and, you know, an actor-based piece of singing, which is fantastic.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, no. You get to play scenes within the songs, you know what I mean? That's when it's thrilling, right? When you can trick the audience into thinking it's easy.
Utterly thrilling.
Yeah.
And you did, am I right in saying you did A Man of No Importance as well?
Yes, my first really great job in New York was A Man of No Importance. I did a play, Dan Sullivan, who I'll always be so grateful for. I was just a young, like, punk-ass kid, didn't go to conservatory, never really studied anything.
Did you just start?
I came to New York and auditioned for a couple of touring companies, one of West Side Story, which I booked as a Tony understudy, the non-dancing jet, whose character name was Guitar. I did that for a year. And then I went out on the road with Miss Saigon, and I played Chris in Miss Saigon for almost 1,200 performances. So I moved to New York, like, I'm sure people thought of me as strictly a singer.
Right.
And then Dan Sullivan just plucked me out of an audition and put me in a play called Spinning Into Butter at Lincoln Center, a Rebecca Gilman play. And at that point, it sort of got me on this interesting path of being able to sort of have one foot in the play world and one foot in the musical world. And soon after that was A Man of No Importance.
Right. With a wonderful company of people.
Oh my God, Faith Prince and the incomparable Roger Reese.
Just absolutely incomparable, that man.
Yeah,
he and I did that, you know, we did the visit together up at Williamstown, which...
Of course, I'm so sorry to have missed that, John, my God.
Well, listen, you and most people, I mean, it was all for such a short time.
Story of my life, John.
Yeah, you know what, like, you've just mentioned...
Better hurry.
You mentioned in Roger Reese and in Faith Prince, two of the people who were in Faith, I did this piece with her called Acadid Affair. Mm-hmm. And the visit were two of the things that I'm most proud of in my career. and they were both on for 2 minutes flat. You know, it's just like, what
it
can
never
you do?
Failed, right? It never yeah, fails.
And that's okay, though. I think if you go with that, it's okay. I just never have any expectation of it doing well, so that's fine.
Yeah, but, I learned that lesson with the Bridges of Madison County. I remember thinking, oh, this is Jason Robert Brown and Bart Scheer. I'm going to just settle into this run. I'm going to do 12 months, and then I'll slide into something else for 12 months.
That's like, right.
Nope.
Nope.
Not, that's not how it works.
Nope, it's just not how it works.
There's no rhyme or reason.
Yeah, but Roger Rees, oh God. Of course, you know, for me, I can remember him as Nicholas Nickleby in London, and I kind of grew up watching him as an actor. Mm-hmm. And it was just wonderful to work with him because he was so naughty and so humble and so accomplished all at the same
that's
time.
Right. That's right. The mischief underneath the sort of like accomplishment of his work is what makes him so great. I learned so much from him. He was like a masterclass every day.
Yeah.
And you know what he always was like fun and kind. Even when he needed something, he was like kind of sweet and kind and fun about it. Even if he really needed something from somebody.
Always.
And that was such a good lesson as a young actor.
Always. But with those pieces, that piece or Bridges, I mean, you were in at the beginning of something. You were at the making of something. Do you like that process? Do you like the process of being, you know, from the start?
Yeah. Very much, yeah. I mean, I came into Men of No Words when they were about to open. They had replaced.
Oh, did you?
But with Bridges, I did a handful of the workshops. And I find them so incredibly valuable. Not just for me, but for them too. Like to see what it feels like in my body. And I also sort of feel, frankly, like I'm helpful in the room to the writers.
Yeah.
And that part is quite thrilling.
Yeah, it is thrilling. It is. I mean, yeah, I never know what I really feel about all those laboratories and all those workshops when they're just done to save the producer's money. That always makes me uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Because I like a long rehearsal period. But but my goodness, the opportunity to work with actors on text without the pressure, you know.
Yeah.
I don't like them when they're, well, it's all to find out about the script, but we want you to put on 3 performances at the end for all these backers, I think. Excuse me.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, no, that's
two ideas right. That can't exist at the same time.
They do not exist at the same time. Absolutely not.
Now, John, do you do a lot of developmental stuff at CSE?
Not really. We've, you know, by the very nature of the fact that it's classic stage company,
right,
it's harder because classics tend to be written by dead people. I've changed that quite a bit in the time I've been there, because obviously, thank God, Mr. Sondheim and Mr. Wyburn aren't, they, you know, they're with us very much.
They're with us, thank God.
Yeah, and you know, I did an adaptation of Dead Poets Society, the writers who wrote the movie script, and he's very much alive. And then, although sadly he's no longer with us, I did Terence McNally's last play.
Oh, R.I.P.
We did that. So if the piece has got a kind of classical reference, I mean, Terence's last play was about dance and about classical ballet going into the Ballet Russe and becoming Nijinsky and the change of what that did to choreography. And so that had a kind of classical nature to it, you know, but there's no point in us doing things that are set in a, you know, around a sofa. I mean, it doesn't make any sense because people expect something else when they come to the classics. You know, I've tended to look at, to use my opportunity there to look at pieces that aren't otherwise seen. Like when we did Carmen Jones, the musical the year before last, the Hammerstein piece, which is never done, you can do something like that at classic stage because you've got 200 seats, you can sort of take the risk of something that's never done and maybe find out why it isn't done, or maybe find out why it should be done. You know, that's the sort of stuff I've been doing more of. I mean, I've been trying hard to get people away from thinking that the classics are things that are written by long since dead white men, you know. I mean all of those things, you know. We have to open our eyes to the classicism that's in everybody and people's human stories and world stories. So that's what I try to approach. And then also, of course, the thing that I'm really interested in, hence one of the reasons why we're doing Assassins, is I am very interested in political theatre. I always have been. Yeah. I grew up with it. It makes people slightly uncomfortable when you put those two words together in America.
I think it's essential right now. I mean, has there ever been a time where the role of the artist has been more important?
Deeply, deeply essential. Yes.
I can't think of a I can't think of a time in American history ever when the role of the artist was more essential than now.
That's right. And the reason why we tell stories and our job to reflect society as it really is, not a kind of romanticized version of society, but for what it really is. Yeah, I mean, you know, it's been so interesting programming there for all these reasons. There's never enough time and, of course, never enough money to do what one would really like to do. You know, it's challenging. And my goodness me, moving forward, if we're talking about the Broadway movement being a challenge, the off-Broadway movement, it's going to be very challenging for companies.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure a lot will have to close their doors even after this.
I fear so. I hope not, but I fear so. I mean, I feel that we're okay, and we have a great board and a lot of support. And, you know, we've been around for a long time, so there's a sort of history of support for the company. That will certainly help us. Yeah. But even then, it's still a challenge.
I just can't imagine the city without CSC and you know, these are essential to the lifeblood of this city.
They truly, truly are. But I sort of, maybe I've just been an optimist for too long. I think it'll be okay. I think it'll be harder maybe on the companies who are trying to find their feet, you know, trying to get going. That's going to be tough, really.
I think you're right. I think we may enter a golden age of something after this is all over. That's what I choose to believe.
I choose to believe that too. And you know, when people talk about, it happens to me with my wonderful board, you know, we will have a conversation about finances and people will say, oh, well, look, you know, this is such a very risky time. And my response is, well, when has it not been a risky time? When is the theater being anything other than a risk?
It's an entirely high risk line of work.
It's a madness. Yeah. And in that madness lies something remarkable, you know. Just going back to talk about Sweeney Todd, the piece that I brought here and makes me able to work in America. We would never have met each other had it not been for my having done that show because of my being around. When I made that piece, we couldn't afford a designer. That's why I designed it myself. That was the beginning of my design career. I mean, like, that was
all the reasons that made that show kind of small is the reason that it was such a success. Interesting, right?
Precisely right.
Yeah.
Precisely right. And somehow for us all to take that. I mean, I don't mean that I want everybody not to earn much money, but there's a job to be done, I think, in looking at what philanthropy means in the American theater and how do we, I don't know how we do this. We'll need a democratic government to do it with. But how do artists have a voice at the table where you can say, you need to put money into the arts. It's part of educating people. It's part of education. That has to happen. A big dream has to be made for the arts in America, I think.
Yeah. I think it's coming. I think it's coming. I think a whole generation of young people are finally really saying, like, holy cow, did you guys screw this up for a little while?
That's right.
You know, and they're going to take that pendulum and really thrust it the other way for a while.
That's right.
I think that has
to. So listen,
I wanted to gush about your Sweeney Todd for a second, and your assassins, because I was always thought what an impossible task asking people on stage to play instruments while they're singing. I thought there's no way you can pull it off. It's too difficult an ask. Yeah. I was one of those people who was like, there's no way that could work.
Yeah.
I thought that was just that evening of theater was just exquisite. And so beautifully done. And I would argue the sort of actor-musician philosophy maybe has never worked better than in the case of Assassins.
I think that's right.
It's so screaming for it.
Yeah, sort of screaming for it. I think what happened with Sweeney Todd, I'd been making work like that for a long time before it came here, and it had never been seen in quite that way in America. And that was a wonderful thing to happen. I thought it might get booed off the stage, but it didn't. because the actor-musician element is a means to an end. I mean, what it is it's an ultimate form of storytelling. It's truly that, you know, it's trying to look at how do you use all the skills that are in the room to tell the story. And they can all be different skills. Not everybody, as we prove with Assassins, not everybody in the room is an acting musician, but everybody is musical, everybody's a musician, everybody's contributing in a different way. And I think I think there's something about that that has, I'm pleased to say, I don't want to use the word proud, but I'm pleased to say has affected the American theatre. You know, there are many shows that had it not been for that Sweeney Todd, there are shows that wouldn't have happened without that production.
And it's so raw, it's like the basic tenets of storytelling when you see people just pull out their instruments.
That's right.
And then all of a sudden they're in the scene and singing the songs. It's so...
That's right. And, you know, the Greeks did it. Bertolt Brecht did it. It's not, you know, I didn't create it. It's, you know, it's been around, but fitting it into is the wrong way to express it. But making it part of the American musical has been very interesting.
And I think it works so well in the case of Assassins, because you haven't done it with everybody, right? So it's about, it's like a handful of people, but they're essential storytellers.
That's right. And it was always the decision that the Assassins themselves wouldn't play. Almost as a statement in their own right, you know, that wouldn't be the case.
As if they've wandered into this evening.
That's right.
Not knowing what the hell's going to happen.
That's right. That's right.
Part, yeah.
So listen, I asked you if you would share something with us, like a quote or a poem or whatever. Have you got something?
I've got a great thing for you. This is something I share with my students every spring that I teach at the NYU grad program. Mm-hmm. And because we talk a lot about how you define success if you're somebody who aspires to be an actor.
Yeah.
And it was this completely broken way of looking at it in a completely capitalist America, which is, I think a lot of people say it's got to be movie stardom or A-list million-dollar contracts or covers of magazines, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. So I always say to them, like, you define how you define your own success is up to you.
Yeah.
And if you attach yourself to an outcome, the outcome doesn't happen, the journey didn't matter. You know what I mean? So it's like about the journey. And so I read this book called Chairs Are Where the People Are many years ago. And there's a great quote about how to properly play the game. And the game can apply to the entertainment business. It can apply to sports. It can apply to chess.
Yep.
It goes like this. In order to enjoy the game, and all these games need to be enjoyed to be played properly, you need to figure out how to take pleasure in having limited control over what happens. If you want the pattern to unfold exactly as you want them to, you will find the game frustrating. At the same time, if you have no attachment to the outcome, you will find the game boring. The best thing is to set an intention, yet be open to surprise. Wonderful. And I always feel like that's the only way you can live an actor's life, because it's just too crazy to attach yourself to anything else.
That's right. There's a song that Sondheim, and Weidman, of course, but that Sondheim wrote in Roadshow called Everything That Happens Is the Game. That is what we're doing. It's just a game, really.
Yeah, the game of life, really.
A game of life. And that we all came into the theatre because we wanted to play, whatever playing means. But I think there was something you said, that it said there in the middle about, I can't remember, but something about expectation. I mean, like, don't expect, you know?
Yeah, that's right. If you want the pattern to unfold exactly as you want them to, you'll find the game frustrating.
That's right.
Right? Which is true, because that's our business in a nutshell. If you attach yourself to any outcome, and it doesn't happen, then you've lived a frustrating existence.
That's right. And that there is no... I mean, I'm always fascinated by that. People talk about, you know, the business or the profession. And I think, well, I'm not sure about those words. I mean, it's a lottery, really, our business. You know, I'm an old man, but I mean, like, when I there were 40 of us in my year at theatre school. I think I'm the only one still working. And there were many of them who were much better than me. It's just like, there's so much chance.
Yes. Much lottery. So much love.
So much.
Somebody taking a chance on you.
That's right.
Generation earlier saying they want to, you know.
That's right.
Yeah.
We all need a Dan Sullivan. We all need what he did for you. I mean, is that...
You know, it's funny. I don't know if Dan Sullivan even knows he is that for me in my mind.
Sure.
He's the person that sort of gave me my real start, where people started thinking of me as an actor.
That's right. So listen, if you were sent onto this desert island that this is all sort of based around, would you... I'm going to ask you a few questions about your desert island. Would you... Do you think you'd survive?
Well, would I have to wear a mask if I'm on a desert island?
No.
Great. I'm there.
You'd be by yourself.
Great. I'm on my way.
You're on your way.
And so, what was the question?
And if you were allowed a luxury to your desert island, what would it be?
Oh man, a luxury to my desert island, I would have to be some sort of food-oriented situation. Like,
really?
I would eat. My luxury would be eating delicious things, crab legs.
Okay, endless amounts of delicious food. That's all right. That's allowed. And finally, you have you're given some books. You're given a religious book, the Bible or whatever anybody's faith is. You're given that book. You're given the complete works of Shakespeare.
Yes.
And you're allowed one more book. What would it be?
Oh, that's such a good question. You know, I may be a theater geek for a second and have Arthur Miller's Death of a Salesman with me. I think it's perfect. I think it's a perfect piece of writing. I might read that on my desert island.
It is a perfect piece of writing. In fact, his autobiography, Time Bends, is my desert island book.
You know what? I haven't read that, and now I'm going to start this week.
I'll read it.
Time Bend. Got it.
Time Bends. It's all about how throughout all of our lives we bend time. We associate things that we think happened in an order, but really they didn't. It's just we remember them in that order and the different connections.
I can't wait to read that, actually. That's a great recommendation. You
know, if we're talking about who's America's great classical writer, it's Arthur Miller.
It has to be.
It has to be. I mean, those plays are remarkable and they go across cultures and generations. And
I think the only person that can approach that pantheon is Stephen Sondheim, really.
Absolutely.
You know?
Absolutely.
A couple of hacks, Arthur Miller and Stephen Sondheim.
Yeah. Hopeless. Stephen, it's lovely to see you. Lovely to talk
John,
to you.
John, I can't wait to get back in a rehearsal room with you.
We'll get there.
Your Connecticut home looks just positively cozy back there.
It's very nice here.
Woodworking, yes.
Come and see it. Walk in the garden. It's very beautiful. It's very, very
nice. You're on.
Take care, my friend.
Okay, John, talk soon.
I'll see you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye.
I do hope you enjoyed our chat. Please spread the word if you can by liking us on Facebook or subscribing to us on YouTube. We want as many people as possible to share our conversations and to stay in touch with the production in readiness for its return. Our future is dependent on generosity. So many people have recently reached out to us and helped us in many, many ways, either ways of encouragement or with financial help. If you can help us in any way at all, please visit our website, classicstage.org. Thank you for being with us. And on behalf of all of us at Classic Stage, stay safe.